Penguin Random House Audio presents Indentured, the Inside Story of the Rebellion Against the NCAA by Joe Nocera and Ben Strauss. Read for you by Dominic Hoffman. Prologue. Why do they hate me so much? Ryan Boatwright was in trouble with the National Collegiate Athletic Association even before he played his first game as a freshman point guard for the University of Connecticut Huskies. Boatwright had arrived at UConn in the fall of 2011 from Aurora, Illinois, a town of 200,000 an hour west of Chicago, with a per capita income that ranks at 261st among Illinois cities. His mother, Tanisha Boatwright, was a single mom struggling to raise four children. Her job as a customer service representative for a healthcare company earned her a paycheck that was not much better than minimum wage. Her father had been a well-known local track coach, and she'd run track herself in high school before she got pregnant with Ryan when she was 17. It was obvious early on that her son was also athletically gifted, despite his lack of size. He never grew taller than 5'10". Basketball was his game. And both he and his mother came to see the sport as his ticket to a better life, not just for himself, but for his family. When he was 13, he attended a basketball camp run by Tim Floyd, then the basketball coach at the University of Southern California. Floyd became so enamored with Boatwright that he offered him a scholarship on the spot. Floyd resigned a few years later after being tarred by a recruiting scandal. At East Aurora High School, Boatwright started as a freshman. 3 years later, as the team's senior point guard, he averaged over 30 points a game and was named Illinois' co-Mr. Basketball. Like many top high school athletes, Boatwright also played for a local amateur athletic union, AAU team. His coach, Reggie Rose, the brother of Chicago Bulls star Derrick Rose, was a long-standing friend of his mother's, and over time, he became a father figure to Boatwright. During a particularly stressful period in the Boatwright household, Rose got Ryan out of Aurora, taking him to California, where he spent several days working out with other good players, another thing the best high school players commonly do. When Tanisha bought a used car, a 2008 Chevrolet Impala she needed to get to her job, Rose helped her with some of the payments. And when Boatwright went on his recruiting visits, he made four trips in all, including one to the UConn campus in Storrs, Connecticut. Rose covered the cost of an additional plane ticket so that Tanisha could go too. Most people would view these as acts of generosity, a friend helping out a friend with fewer resources. But the NCAA, which had been tipped off about the money Rose gave Tanisha, saw them as potential, nay, likely, violations of its amateurism rules. That's why Boatwright was in trouble. Since the early 1950s, the NCAA has served as the powerful overlord of college sports, with one central tenet, that college athletes, whether gymnasts or quarterbacks, must be unpaid amateurs, for whom sports is little more than a sideline to their academic pursuits. As the NCAA puts it in its bylaws, student participation in intercollegiate athletics is an avocation, and student athletes should be protected from exploitation by professional and commercial enterprises. The NCAA's long-standing insistence that amateurism is the core value of college sports has always been more than a little hypocritical, as has the idea that the NCAA was somehow preventing, as opposed to enabling, their exploitation. Has there ever really been a time when the athletes in the so-called revenue sports that are the focus of this book, football and men's basketball, weren't expected to put their sport first and their studies a distant second, while helping to bring glory and money to their school? Has there ever been a time when college athletes weren't at some level exploited? Long before coaches made millions and the NCAA turned its annual basketball championship into the financial windfall known as March Madness, critics have complained about the pervasive commercialism of college athletics. But with the NCAA now generating over $900 million in annual revenue, with athletic conferences owning their own lucrative all-sports cable networks, with coaches making $5 million, Jim Harbaugh, Michigan football, or $7 million, Nick Saban, Alabama football, or even $10 million, Mike Krzyzewski, Duke basketball, and with ESPN paying $7.3 billion over 12 years for the rights to the new college football playoff, the idea that players who make all this possible should not get much more than a scholarship isn't just hypocritical. It's offensive. An economist named Dan Rasher, who was a character in this book, estimates that college sports in its totality generates some $13 billion, which, incredibly, is more than the most lucrative professional sports league in America, the National Football League. Before we go any further, a few facts. More than 460,000 NCAA athletes participate in 24 sports across its three divisions. Supporters of the status quo like to point out that the system as currently constructed maximizes opportunities for the largest number of athletes. Think of all the scholarships for tennis players and swimmers. Our book is focused on the 15,000 athletes playing top-level football and nearly 5,500 in Division I men's basketball, because they produce the revenue that pays for everything, from those expensive football coaches' salaries to track and field scholarships. Indeed, most schools' athletic department budgets remain separate from central administration. But while the college sports establishment squeezes every last dollar out of their marquee athletes, weekday night games, schools jumping from conference to conference, and a rash of corporate sponsors, they must remain amateurs, while a little more than 5% of them go on to careers in the NBA or NFL. The NCAA has consistently refused to acknowledge this hypocrisy. Instead, it has held tightly to the centrality of amateurism, even as it has encouraged the commercialization of college sports in every other way imaginable. And over the years, it has enforced its amateurism rules with a Javert-like zealotry. Until very recently, athletes could receive nothing for playing their sports beyond their athletic scholarship, plus a Pell Grant if they were poor enough to qualify. As this book details, the NCAA has recently allowed schools to add a stipend to cover the full cost of attendance beyond the scholarship itself. Anything else these athletes receive that the NCAA deems to be the result of their skill or fame, no matter how inconsequential, is considered a violation of its rules and is therefore punishable. And it's not only while they're in college. If a high school athlete or his parents gets money or gifts as a result of his status as an athlete, that too is punishable once the player gets to college and comes under the scrutiny of the NCAA. 8 months before Boatwright's problems, for instance, a freshman basketball player named Perry Jones III, the star center for the Baylor University Bears, was suspended for 6 games because his mother, who had been out of work due to a heart condition, had accepted and quickly repaid several short-term loans from Jones's AAU coach to cover her rent. Jones had been in the 10th grade when this happened and had never known about the loans. Although the NCAA had earlier allowed Auburn star quarterback Cam Newton to play in a lucrative bowl game after it was alleged that his father had tried to auction him off to the highest bidder, on the grounds that Newton hadn't known what his father was doing, it took the opposite stance with Jones. His suspension was announced, cruelly, just before Baylor's opening round conference tournament game, creating a swirl of publicity that humiliated the teenager while dooming the Baylor team to defeat with Jones out of action. When I asked an NCAA spokeswoman why it had let Newton play while punishing Jones, all she would say is, "Every situation is different." Really? It was Boatwright's new coach, Jim Calhoun, who first informed Tanisha in November 2011 that her son had been declared ineligible by the school because the NCAA had some questions about his recruitment, as he put it to her. That's the way the system works. The NCAA itself doesn't declare a player ineligible. It forces the school to do so. Because if the school doesn't, and the NCAA rules against the player, the team will forfeit any game he has played when he should have been ineligible. Plus, that allows the NCAA to claim piously that it isn't the responsible party when a player becomes ineligible. The university is.
Within a day or two. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.